happening right now.
A 6-foot-tall can of Coors Light might actually be able to give you a buzz.
Oh, that's the professionals that we are. We'll be here all day, motherfuckers.
But our guests will not, so we should probably welcome her in here. Amber Lyon is out in the green room.
Let's go. Holy shit.
Hey.
Wow. You sound like, cause I got, you know what I mean? Like, Donald Schultz told me about you, Amber, and then I got this stuff here, and I'm like, you did a lot of stuff that I am the opposite of. You're like, these are some serious accomplishments in the real world. Like, you're a real journalist, but you're like spastic heart. Why would you just do that job? Like, why do you
get shot at and taken prisoner?
Did you just get the gig immediately because you're like, I want to be a reporter? And the guys at the top are like, yeah, whatever you want to do, whatever job you want to have, go for it.
Yeah, kind of.
Makes sense.
Yeah.
Because the reporters are, you know what I mean? They're like tolerably, you can look at them, you can handle it. The guys are always, to me, I analyze it a little more than the average bear because I don't really care what they're saying. So I start looking at people's faces and haircuts to see if I can judge their life. Because, you know, everyone pretends on TV that they're super happy and everything's great. And I'm really sorry to hear about that kid that died. But really, he has a cocaine problem and he drinks till 4 a.m, gets kicked out of the bar every night, shows up with a weird hangover and like, The guy on KTLA, that's my prediction for
that. And they all talk like this, you know?
So
they have that reporter voice that just, it's not even real.
I've been saying this for years.
Teach them in journalism school.
If a TV news anchor moved in next door to you and carried themselves with that kind of physicality and had that haircut and talked that way, you would either call the police or you would call NASA to report an alien. Like, we just accept the fact that this is what news people act like, and yet if you met a person like that in real life, they would freak you the hell out. They don't act human.
I think they are aliens a little bit. I mean, to sit there and read a script off a prompter all day long, every day. I mean, there's not much difference between them and robots and aliens. It really freaks me out. They tried to get me to do that in journalism school to talk in that Ron Burgundy-esque evening news voice.
Will does it on the radio. They were the first person I ever heard on radio. Hey, Will, do your radio thing.
Good afternoon, everybody. It's 74 degrees.
See? and then I came on, and I'm like, you don't expect me to try and imitate that. Because I always got out of it because I got an accent. I'm like, you can't make me try to sound like an American. It won't work. So I'm just going to talk like a normal person. But I always hated that. That was hard for me to like Will because he would talk like that on the radio and it would make me, I'm like, how can you be my friend? You're full of shit. But he kind of talks like that. I think he did it for so long that he kind of is genuinely saying it's 7:00. You know, I think sometimes he calls me and tells me what time it is and how hot it is outside. I'm like, what the fuck, dude? Leave me alone.
So that's what we need to remember. The lesson from this conversation is most people that talk like that are full of shit. So don't listen to what they're telling you on the news.
The guys are always really starchy. And I don't know if this is true as much now as it was 10 or 15 years ago, but I always felt like there were a lot of women who would chew on their cheeks to try to sound a little bit more intelligent. You know, crisis today in war-torn Nicaragua. Yeah. Like, as if you're chewing on your own mouth, that makes you a little bit more of a stern individual.
Yeah. You sound more intelligent.
Exactly. I blame Diane Sawyer.
You go to the gym all the time, Amber?
I do a lot of yoga and work out, yeah.
Is that why you got a happy face? You got a yoga face.
Oh, I do. Yeah, or I just did yoga this morning.
It could be your ayahuasca face, because I noticed that all you bastards, no offense, have that weird like twinkle in your eye from doing it. It's kind of pissing me off because I want to have a fucking twinkle in my eye. I'm scared.
They call it the ayahuasca glow.
Is that what it is?
Essentially what the ayahuasca does is just like cleanses your soul, your whole body, gets rid of all the crap you've had built up for your whole life, and then you just come out. For most people, some have a horrific experience, but for most people you come out just kind of glowing. You feel lighter and just really a lot happier. I brought you a piece of ayahuasca too, by the way.
For what?
From Peru.
But wait, do I eat it?
No, you just keep it. It's good luck.
Oh, God. I was like, man, you're going to make me do it right now? This is going to be a tough show.
It's just, no, not to actually take it now.
Okay,
but,
don't lick
but
it.
Just keep this bad boy for good luck and kind of hang it in your car maybe.
Why are you so
reminds
nice to
you
me?
On a daily basis.
Oh, look, it's an actual
the ayahuasca's calling.
Wow, it's the piece of the, so if I, can I just like suck on that and start tripping balls?
No, because you need the leaves that have DMT. So you mix the ayahuasca vine with the leaves that have DMT, And then that sends you into another universe.
Fit over my giant head. Keep going.
It looks really good.
I had to put it on. It. Let's see if it frees me.
So you're a little scared to try ayahuasca there.
Yeah, because I got...
And you just told him that ayahuasca is the greatest roller coaster that's ever been created, except from time to time one of the cars derails and everyone dies.
Yes. Yeah. I mean, some people...
That's call exactly
it work.
What I heard, too. That's crazy.
They call it work for a reason. It's not easy. It's not all rainbows and butterflies. Some people have horrific experiences. Mm-hmm. But at the end of the day, after you have some of the worst experiences are the most healing. And you come out maybe 5 days later feeling better once you get your head around it. But it's not easy for everyone.
Well, I'm actually, Donald Schultz has talked to me about it. Aubrey Marcus has told me about it. And through Aubrey, I've met other people that have done it. Some people have come on the show. I watched a documentary about it. I had a heart procedure like a month and a half ago because my heart would go into AFib if I stressed it out. So they've supposedly that's going to be fixed. They said it's fixed, but I have to stay on these meds for another 30 days. But after that, I said to Aubrey, I want to do it. But now, just like Telly said, what I just heard was, because that's you know, when you kind of feel like that's what's going to happen, you almost project that onto yourself.
Yes.
It's going to happen. Like when I go to Peru and I take ayahuasca and then sniff from the 400-year-old bone, I am going to fucking bleed. Like it is going to be so bad because I'm going to die and face all these things that I have, that I am running from. But as long as my heart doesn't kill me in the freak of it all, that's all I really care about. I can go through hell, and as long as like eventually I wake up and become me again, I'm okay with it because I got kids too. That's the other thing.
And it's probably too because you have probably the reason you may be having heart problems. I'm not a doctor, but I just know anecdotally from my journalistic work on all these medicines is it's kind of built up trauma and built up negative energy that often causes hypertension or rare skin disorders, rare diseases. And what the ayahuasca and a lot of these psychedelic medicines are good at doing is just helping people purge that trauma. And then you live with less anxiety, less stress, and then that overall, at the end of the day, will hopefully help your heart condition.
See, that's why I would do it. That's why I think I will do it. But I have to get very, very ready for it because that's just who I am. I have to be very, very ready. I have to have everything prepared just in case things go bad. I need like things for the kids and stuff because you never know. Going to another country and doing that stuff is weird. You said bad things happen to some people.
Well, I think that they just see scary visions. Or for some people, it's like putting a mirror up to your soul. So you've been living this personality your whole life that really isn't you.
Yeah.
And maybe you've been treating people poorly. And the ayahuasca is not shy about showing you that right away.
I think I'll be all right with that. I think I just got to talk to a bunch of dead people I'm scared of. That's all.
That happens to a lot of people, too. They report being visited by dead relatives or family members and really kind of even ancestors and just dealing with actually sitting there and communicating with someone who is no longer there is pretty scary for many people, but also healing as well.
You're super hot. You have like a weird energy. I know it's maybe that thing, but I feel like if I was with you, and I don't even have to actually have it in there, I'd just hug you for a long time, that there'd be some sort of ray that would come on me and make me shine more.
Yeah.
So you seem like.
I'd lay
I'm
next
sure
to you.
I'm sure you hear that all the time.
Yeah, sure. I'd sit next to you. I'd hold your hand through the process, make sure
I feel safer now already.
Well. Yeah. Are you scared to go to the jungle? That's usually 90% of the battle for people. Oh, yeah, you're an Aussie. Never mind.
Yeah,
you're
I'm a wanker. I want to be in there.
Yeah.
I don't really know what Emmys are, but I know that they're a big deal and you've won three of them and then you did something completely like how do you get involved in being a reporter and then decide to do a documentary that can cause that much of a ruckus? You're going on a quest.
Yeah,
like, where do you go there?
I just felt a calling. I was over in covering all the revolutions in the Middle East.
Your choice to go there or did your boss send you?
It was a little bit of both. It kind of, the opportunity presented itself and I wanted some adventure and I wanted to go travel to this area of the world and just see what was going on. And I really liked how people were actually standing up for their rights and protesting.
So you noticed that when you got there, that people were really trying to...
Oh yeah, they're trying to become more democratic. In a lot of the countries, they're really trying to throw out these dictator regimes and really
you immediately felt for them and became more on their side.
Mm-hmm.
Instantly.
Yeah. Yeah, just for the people. Just wanted to help them out and use my blonde Midwestern face and personality to be able to translate their message to Middle America.
I get that, because you would stand out in Beverly Hills, let alone over there. You got that, like I said, you got all shiny and shit. You can see it from the inside.
So you're over there covering the Arab Spring. What challenges? I mean, I hate to even have to ask this question, but your job would have been easier, I'm assuming. It's hard enough for any outsider, but a female outsider had to be doubly difficult.
Oh, yeah, for sure. I mean, even when we'd go to cover a protest like in Egypt, there's a lot of worry about a reporter right before me who was blonde as well was drug away in a crowd. She worked for 60 Minutes and they tried to rape her and molested her. And so this was like a week before I got on the ground. So I had to have a security guard with me, and then we'd had to put on like 3 belts just in case I was drug away. It would take, you know, 3 belts and then also tie an Egyptian flag on me so no one could say I was Israeli. So it was really stressful. And then in the meantime, I'm trying to get video shots and make sure we have the right interviews and always looking over my shoulder. But luckily, I didn't have any problems there. Just kind of in the country of Bahrain, that's when we ran into a lot of issues.
You were detained at gunpoint.
Yes.
So what is the story? What is the story that you were witnessing and trying to take away with you?
So in Bahrain, the U.S. is supporting the regime there. Surprise, surprise. They're supporting a dictator regime. I mean, they're doing this all over the world.
That's so us.
In that country in particular, it's really sad because the majority of the people, they want this regime out. And if it wasn't for the U.S., they could get the regime out and have their freedom. But the U.S. keeps giving this regime all this money and these weapons. And
what's the justification for that?
They want to keep their military base in this country because it lets them keep an eye on Iran. And strategically, worldwide, it's great positioning. It's like a great position on the chessboard.
Smart. We're good, aren't we, Michael?
Evil and smart.
We're the best.
The worst kind.
I know.
Getting it done.
So go ahead.
And so I just wanted to tell these people's story and translate it to Middle America and say, look, your tax dollars are going to support this regime that's murdering and torturing journalists. I had a journalist friend who was murdered, doctors, teachers, anyone who was really prominent and then standing up against the regime was getting tortured and killed. And
you've got video proof of all of this, mm-hmm. and you're going to come back to America and you're going to do this documentary. So they don't even want to let you out with it, but you did make it out with it. And then when you get there, then your bosses are like, we're not running this shit.
Yeah, they didn't run it on CNN International, which was the most important network to air the video on because it...
But they did run it somewhere?
They ran it on CNN US once and then pulled it from CNN International. And that was really devastating to me and my crew at the time because we'd gone to such great lengths.
She life's work. It's your baby.
Yeah, of course. You know, we wanted to give this evidence and show people in America what the U.S. government was doing overseas.
Right, and I feel like you found out, and then people can gather the information and decide for themselves. You don't have to write up, like you said. It's a really good spot to be in. And I don't know if the government was like, look, you don't understand. If we're not there, then we could be subjected to something terrible, or you know what I mean. And I go, well, I don't fucking know. Like she says that, and you say that. Everyone can have an opinion, but it's weird how you can't tell everybody that. I figure at this day and age, just say it, and then everyone can decide. What, I don't think we can even change it anyway. Honestly, if it just kept running and everyone's like, this is ridiculous, we need to put this to a stop. Do you think that you could? Do you think anyone would?
Potentially. I think it would at least wake people up because everyone, we're experiencing a global revolution of consciousness right now. I mean, so many people with the internet are just waking up each day to the realities of what's happening worldwide. And I think this would just be another way that people could realize what was happening in this country. And the people were actually pressuring the U.S. government to then pressure Bahrain to release political prisoners. So it was working at the time when I was able to actually get on the air and report on this.
Do you have to watch out now for doing that?
Like,
do you
I hope not.
You have to pay extra taxes or something? Like some asshole's just like, really? Here you go. Here's some, you have to pay this much for almost routing us out. You're okay? Nobody's like following you or anything?
Not that I know of.
You never seen like a bunch of dudes with sunglasses and black suits on?
Yeah. That happened to me on one investigation.
It did?
I was in, yeah. I've had a pretty tumultuous career.
It looks that way.
Tell me about it. Tell me about the suit guys.
So I was covering pain clinics in Florida, which is these clinics, they sell OxyContin. It's
ooh.
It's really like a semi-legal drug trade going on there. And I went in and snuck in as a patient and got all this evidence that all these people were in there just getting these pills to flood the market with these pills. And it's really horrific when people get addicted to oxycodone, OxyContin.
Yeah.
They can't get off. It's, it's nearly impossible. And so these clinics were just flooding the market with these pills. So I went in as a patient, went through, saw that it was almost, it was ridiculous, the screening process to get the pills. And then somehow they realized I was a reporter. I think it's because I did come back and try to confront them. And then
wow.
I was walking in Miami.
She's super
Beach.
Hot, but dating her would be super tough. She's very, she's going to get in your face when there's any, like if you leave the dishes out, like she's going to get up in your grill. We're going to have this finished done. You get to solve the problem right now. Anyway, so you go in there and you tell them, you give them a piece of your own mind, and then?
And then they, you know, they start, like, cussing me out and telling me my cameras to leave.
You went in with cameras?
Yeah, just to the parking lot.
And do you get nervous when you're about to do that? Because I do this radio show, and we've talked about going on the street and actually getting in someone's face, because I have the brain to be very annoying to people. And I'm bigger. I could punch you before you punch me, but I would, it's very uncomfortable to me. Like, I won't have guests come on this show that people would like, because we know we don't like each other. I don't want to have a confrontation with anybody. You know when you're going in there with cameras that it is about to be, remember me? And then they're going to get pissed. You don't get really anxious about that? Do you like it?
No, I just felt, you know, maybe a part of me was kind of searching for a confrontation at that point.
Right? Because I feel why would you keep getting yourself in these spots?
Well, and I was young. I was young and naive. And so I went in with the camera and this woman came out and started cussing me out. And then they brought out these big bouncers. And that's when I knew I needed to GTFO. And then I'm walking down Miami Beach like 2 weeks later. And I guess I had gotten my license plate as we were leaving. And I'm walking with my dog. I'm in like a sundress and flip-flops, just enjoying the beautiful day. And next thing I notice, there's this black Benz right behind me with all tinted windows, just curb crawling me, like driving really, really slow. Yeah. And so I'm walking and I'm just wondering, I'm like, is this some weird guy trying to check me out or
super romantic?
Going on?
I'm going to steal that idea.
Yeah.
My girlfriend's going to be pumped. Friday night, me and the boys all dressed in black, hanging out in the car, just cruising behind her. And then I just jump out and start pumping her on the sidewalk.
Very romantic. What I was like, well, you know, because you're in Miami Beach, like you never know what's going on. There's a lot of strange cats out there. So, but then I stop walking and then the car stops. And then I walk a little faster, and then the car speeds up, and then I realized I was being curb crawled. And so I didn't know what to do. I had, like, my small white dog with me, and so I just went behind this building and kind of hid behind this cement wall and was peering out, and the car was just sitting there waiting for me.
It's like Jason Bourne, but hot.
Yeah.
This is...
And so then I at that point, then I called the police because they were just – it was just waiting. I didn't know what was going on, and So the police came, the car took off. Flash forward several months later, they wanted me to testify against these pain clinic owners because they'd found evidence that they had been stalking me.
Oh.
And that they'd had guns in the car and all this stuff.
Oh,
so,
my.
Yeah, I mean, whenever you're reporting as a journalist on something that involves a lot of cash, you always got to watch your back.
Man, that job is so mellow. We never talk about anybody with any money. Where's the? I know Ken Block. There you go.
I read an article really recently about one of these, like whatever you want to call them, you know, the pill dispensaries. Really, and it seemed like the doctor that this article covered was more or less really a kind of a naive, soft touch. And there are people with legitimate pain, and he's like, "Look, I can't tell if you're lying or not. Nobody else wants to take care of you." Okay, and so, but you're talking about something that's very, very cynical. They knew that they were supplying drugs to addicts.
Oh yeah, in Broward County, Florida, they had more pain clinics than McDonald's at one point. So they were just flooding the
whole
market with
it. That's killing people. That's straight up murder right there. Honestly, like just a thing where anybody who's a junkie can come in and keep getting it. You're killing them. And then, to get a little extra money to sell drugs.
And they're creating new junkies because they were just flooding. Like someone might be 16 at a party.
Right.
This happened to my cousin. He tried. It's weird because it's like, oh, when I was in high school, there was marijuana. And that was about the worst there was. But now OxyContin is, these high schoolers are getting a hold of
OxyContin
it.
OxyContin and butt chugging. The kids are out of their minds. Pissing in their mouths. I'm telling you, I'm glad I'm older. Holy shit. You guys got like Britney Spears and pissing in your own face. We got Doobies and Hendrix and Metallica, you suck. You guys, you kids suck.
I saw that
suck.
Video, the guy's pissing in his, he's an
yeah.
Aussie.
Yeah,
is
oh
this,
yeah, cool,
is this
yeah,
common?
Sure. They do it. No, it's not. No, it's not. They do it here.
They call it bubbling.
I'm not even
bubbling. Oh my gosh.
I'm not even from there. Okay?
Where the hell have I been? I didn't know what bubbling was.
It's very big. It's a rite of passage. Every man teaches his son about bubbling in Australia, right?
Shit, shut up, dude. They do not.
Have you bubbled before?
No. No. I mean, maybe accidentally one time when I passed, I tried to piss in a park. I was really drunk, like next level drunk, and then I went to piss, and when I got my dick out to pee, I fell over, and I was so drunk I couldn't hold the pee in. And I was trying to get up, so every time I put my hand somewhere to get up, I was peeing all over myself. And I remember it might have hit me in the face, but I didn't get a photo and put it up on Instagram. I was blacked out. And then I went to sleep in a tent, and I woke up on my face with my hand underwater, with my cell phone underwater, and it wasn't water. I pissed myself again in the tent. It was like waterproof bottom tent, so I just became a bathtub. And then with the sun, because I was out late, so I was in the sun, it was like I was cooking in my own urine. It was some, and then apparently my friend saw. They said he walked by and he saw a line of ants walking across my foot. It's pretty. That's who you're talking to.
So Amber, was there ultimately any connection between the investigative stuff you're doing with like the legal pain drug trade and then your more recent interest in ayahuasca and DMT and stuff like that?
Yes, 100%. Because I, as a journalist, when I was covering all this, I was literally seeing people die in front of me shooting up these pills, and I was always like, oh my gosh, like where's the solution? And there's this psychedelic from West Central Africa called ibogaine. And it's extremely effective at helping people overcome pill addictions. And psychedelics in general are really amazing at helping people deal with addictions because they force you to look within and kind of get to the root of what's been causing your addiction, which is often childhood trauma or some type of trauma people are carrying around. So I see not only the potential to cure pill addictions, but to really just transform the world, just one individual at a time, because until we can heal at the individual level, collectively we're not going to see change. And when we do each just heal at the individual level, we're going to see really dramatic change for the better in society.
Was your interest primarily academic, or is there a personal element as well?
A personal element too.
And what's the basis of that?
Well, I'd say one too many curb crawls and guns pointed at my head got to me after a while.
Yeah, I was gonna say you might have already been there before that shit happened. You're kind of a thrill seeker to get in there in the first place. So you,
exactly.
I could see that you would want to broaden your horizons more than humanly possible.
Exactly, and I started to develop symptoms of post-traumatic stress disorder.
Okay.
Or a lot of just excess stress. I was never officially diagnosed with it, but I go back and I've looked at the symptoms, and that was what I was experiencing. Sleeplessness, I was having trouble ever sitting still, relaxing. I was constantly hyper-aroused. Whenever I saw men in like military uniforms, I'd start to see tunnel vision and almost have panic attacks because it was reminding me of when my crew and I were taken... were captured in Bahrain. And so I just got to the point I couldn't work anymore. And
wow.
I felt like I wasn't living.
You never did any drugs before this, huh?
None.
Nothing.
Nothing. I
Not
was
even
so
a
anti-drug.
Dude. You were anti.
Because I grew up in middle America. I was fed the propaganda and I assumed that psychedelics were just as bad as crack cocaine or heroin because they've been unfairly grouped as Schedule One, which most psychedelics are more medicinal than actually drugs. But we're very confused because this failed war on drugs has everyone saying like, what the hell is a real drug and what's a medicine?
Wait, real quick, I've got to ask, what's hyper aroused?
You shit, would ask that. So hyper aroused for a woman, it's not what you're thinking.
Okay, that's why I'm asking.
Yeah, because I didn't even catch that. I was getting super excited. I'm like, holy shit, this girl really is the one. Hyper aroused.
I constantly
that's your problem.
Wanted to have sex, and I was having a sex addiction, and I knew I had to take care of it with the ayahuasca.
Okay,
gotcha. It's a button.
Not really, but I just kind of, you're always like on edge. You know, you hear a car door slam. It's like you're
so
jumpy.
I am.
And, mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a.
They're not allowed to move fast out there because if I see them move fast out there, then I have to know what they're doing.
No way, seriously.
I did it today. They all fucking stood up and looked out the window and I stopped the show. I was like, "What the fuck is going on outside?"
Maybe
I got to do it, don't I? I got it.
Yeah, because that's a symptom of. I mean, did you have any childhood trauma?
Tons of it.
Okay.
I was molested by my father and stuff.
Okay, so this is that is definitely going to help you with that. And what happens for most people is what leads you to be prone to getting PTSD is childhood trauma. And for me, my parents had had a very rough, argumentative, crazy divorce as a kid, and I had absorbed that at age four.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't know that that was taking the driver's seat in my life for the, you know, remaining decades. But the psychedelics are great at really showing you that trauma and allowing you to reprocess it, to go back when you were 4 years old, relive it, and then recompartmentalize it in your brain into a safe folder instead of a fear folder, so you no longer have anxiety attached, and then you can just get on with your normal life.
This could be the final conversation about this stuff that seals the deal.
Until the next scary thing she says.
Because she's saying that if it's bad, then, you know, because then it's like it's a bunch of pain and anxiety and you have to go through a bunch of... I do that all the time. I can do that. I just don't want to die. I don't want to do this and then die in Peru and my kids grow up and go, what happened? And like, he fucking took some weird shit and killed himself. You can't do that when you're a father. You just can't. But if it's just... it's the worst experience ever and I like bawl my eyes out and shit myself for 2 days. And then you tell me that in 6 months later, that really helped me face my problems and I can move on from certain things. I mean, I got a good therapist, but it doesn't happen in a day. Like, I try as much as I can. There's only so far I can go because it's still the same world.
I think some people spend decades in therapy. I've talked to people who have, and it when you at that point when it's not working, you know you need to look for other things, and that's why psychedelics are so effective, is because they will bring you back to that trauma, let you reprocess it, and I think for you even MDMA psychotherapy might be extremely effective.
What's that?
It's ecstasy, essentially.
Do an ecstasy again is going to be good for me, because this is very confusing news. Because I'm a guy that has retired from that stuff because I used to do it when I was younger and I did it too much. I was the kind of guy that if we're doing ecstasy, then I would be like, well, give me four. I'm like, what? I'm like, because fucking I need four. Look at me. Give it to me. And then I would just go and do all kinds of weird shit. But anyway,
I didn't
figure anything out.
Well, what you do is you do it in a therapeutic setting. So you have a therapist with you. You put a blindfold on. And it's almost like magic. I've never seen anything like it. I've sat there with someone who had a lot of childhood trauma. He was actually killed by his father at age eight and then came back. His dad had strangled him.
He wins.
And he went back and relived that experience while on the MDMA. And what it does is it calms you down so much. You're relaxing so much. You're able to go back and process things you don't even remember you remember. On this, and it's 83% effective at curing PTSD. So people have tried everything.
Off.
Yeah.
But wait, I go to a doctor and I do a bunch of MDMA and hang out. Like, he has the same MDMA that he always gives because he can't just get like different ones. It's going to be clean.
Yeah, it's
kind
clean.
Of other shit in it.
You can't get stuff on the street. Ecstasy usually is a mix of all these other drugs. You got to get a test kit to even make sure it is real ecstasy.
Are you telling me that there's a doctor that I can see and he will give me some stuff to take and then he will sit there for a few hours with me blindfolded and go through me being on ecstasy?
Yes. But it's all in the underground now. Unfortunately, they've all these amazing heroic therapists, they've had to go into the underground because
why?
It's illegal. Because it's so effective, you know.
Wait,
that's a very, 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 very loaded statement you just slipped out there.
Yeah, because
it's too effective, you see.
It's MDMA.
It's the journalist in me, because other prescription drug companies, they would that are now using the treatments or selling the treatments for PTSD. There's only two medicines approved for PTSD. They aren't too fond of MDMA psychotherapy, and I think they're using their political pressure to keep it illegal because it is so effective. And instead, they're selling the public medicines that the public has to stay on over and over and over that never really gets to the core and cures them. So they'd lose billions if it was legalized.
Acid was primarily used for psychotherapy before people even almost got the hint that they should, wow, this would be fun to just take and party on. I know I'm a big fan of the actor Cary Grant, and he was like a hugely repressed adult who he took acid with his. He was a crazy, distinguished old English man who was like 60 years old and taking acid once a week with his
hell yeah
psychotherapist. And he thought
he sounds like a cool dude.
He's kind of cool in his way, and he thought it was massively helpful to him in overcoming a lifetime of repression and whatever issues he may have had.
Man.
But then the hippies got their hands on it, and you kind of can't blame the feds at that point for wanting to temper it a little bit.
Yeah, they're terrifying people because they're like, drop out. Just drop out of society. And that's what's beautiful about the new revolution in psychedelics is that people are saying, drop out, heal yourself, then come back to society. And that's usually what people are doing. And LSD, an interesting thing about that is Bill Wilson, who founded Alcoholics Anonymous, actually used LSD to cure his debilitating depression and told all the board of AA that he wanted LSD to be a mandatory first step in the 12-step program.
Give the drunks acid.
So that they know what's causing the drinking.
It would make me go.
It's a great bumper sticker.
Yep.
Yeah, and more people would go, and it would get to the root of your problem. What's causing you to drink? What's causing that anxiety? Usually childhood trauma, and the LSD helps people process that as well. So he wanted to add it to the 12 steps, but they kind of kicked him out.
LSD, the 13th step.
Remember when I had the imaginary friend that told me that my father molested me?
Yes.
I was fucking on acid.
That doesn't surprise me, yeah.
And crystal meth and ecstasy, but...
No way, you were on acid at the time?
Yeah, I took... It was after a demo in Australia, like a big... Yeah. One of those tour things, and I was like a rookie, so a tour in front of thousands of people was a big deal, and I did real well, and everybody had tons of drugs, because I think Korn was... Some band, so, you know, I mean, there's like tons of big bands, so there was tons of people with all kinds of drugs. So I had some speed right. I snorted a couple lines of speed after the demo, then took acid, and then later on took ecstasy and was hanging up in the... There was a pool on the roof of the hotel, and everybody had left to go out, and I was obviously way too high to be in public. So my girlfriend at the time was just watching me in the pool, like to make sure I didn't drown, and she said I had an imaginary friend. Like, it got to the point where I was just talking to somebody, and she was asking about it, and I was talking about... You know, the guy that I'm talking to, and then I just went into how my father molested me, and then I didn't even know. I was 21 when this happened.
Oh, so you didn't have the memory?
No one told me that I was molested. I didn't know.
Because often when people are kids and such traumatic things happen, you repress the memory. So, but it's still stored in the back of your head, in the driver's seat. That's the problem, is like a lot of these memories just stay with you for life. So it's key to be able to get in there and get it out and process it. And that's where these medicines are so beautiful doing it. And LSD is also used to help people overcome childhood trauma as well. And there's a lot of therapists, too, who use it in the underground for the same thing.
I'm just starting to realize I'm not finished. I just opened up a door, and now I'm just sitting in it and wallowing in it when I need to get past. Like, I probably need to do some more and get past it even further. Because I said it was – imaginary friend said it was my dad. I told my girlfriend. My girlfriend told my mom. My mom said I thought he forgot about that because it happened when he was young. So I wake up the next day and go, oh my fucking God. Like, you're saying that it really happened. And now I start visioning who it is. And then they tell me there's no way it was your dad. It was the neighbor. He was a babysitter or something. And he had red hair, and that's how it got mixed up. And then I just think about all the things that, because they said when dad found out, he was super angry. I've seen my dad smash somebody's face off on the street for cutting him off in a car, but he didn't punch the person that fucked me when I was 5 years old. Mm. Doesn't make any sense. Yeah. And then when I asked him about it, he asked me about it, and he said, you think he got molested? And I was like, yeah. And he's like, you think it was me? And I was like, nah. And he's like, oh. And then he didn't ask another question. And as a father, if my son's 5 years old right now, first of all, anybody molest my son right now, they're dead. Anybody that tries to stop me is dead as well. And if he remembers it later on and he wants to talk about it, we're talking about it to the bitter end. We're going to therapy and we're having conversations. I know this is a different era, but at least talk to the fucking kid. You're just going to walk off and say that's the end. And then I went to rehab a while ago and started tripping balls in there and remembering even more of it.
Wow.
So it's still going.
That's causing your heart problem because from... I'm not a healer, but I've gotten this healing intuition because I've worked so much with these medicines. But that carrying that built-up trauma or those memories is leading to the way it's manifesting itself. That energy is coming out is in your stress, your hyper arousal, your.
I've got the other hyper arousal.
that issue.
The one that
too.
Turns Tully on.
Yeah.
I'm fully hyped, Tully.
Yeah, I'm well aware.
I'm sorry. Maybe I should get past the end of that. That sounds like another reason to do it.
Yeah, for sure. And
do you
not
still
only
do
that,
it?
Yeah, I do. I do the medicines just a
couple
times
MDMA
a year.
Do you do MDMA blindfolded still?
So I did it once.
Okay.
And I had a memory come up as well that I forgot, and that I had been abused at a babysitter's house. And I was wondering why, and I never knew that had happened. I just, my mind had completely blocked the memory. And so I'm sitting in the middle of this beautiful session. I'm lying down on a bed. I have a blindfold on. I'm deep in the woods of Colorado. And with this amazing couple that gives MDMA therapy, they bring in like firefighters and soldiers and people who have PTSD and people from all over the world and just heal them. They're like so heroic.
Have you ever heard of this, Michael?
No, I haven't.
This is amazing.
And there's all these healers all over the country doing this in the underground because they see how amazingly effective it is. They see that in 6 to 8 hours, they can actually almost completely cure people of PTSD. In 6 to 8 hours. It's really unbelievable.
And man, things are going to be so much. Things are going to be so fun, Michael. New contract. Allowed to do ecstasy again.
You're going to see Dr. Ecstasy.
It's going to be like the old days, man. But like legitimate. You know what I mean? Everything's safe and legal. I'm just legally tripping balls. And fine. Hey, look, man, I got to slot some shit out. I'll be back, kids.
Now,
it's awesome.
What I'm sure you're familiar with this. There was a book written a few years ago about someone basically calling into question the validity of retrieved memories.
Mm-hmm.
Have you ever heard anything about that? That it's had an effect in some court cases of where you just essentially can't trust people to know their own memories, that people can retrieve memories that may not have actually even happened.
I agree with that, but I think that the science also shows with the use of these medicines and psychedelics is it actually unlocks implicit memories. Those are memories stored in your brain that you can't access on your own. Like no matter how hard you tried to think, you couldn't access that memory, but the psychedelic actually unlocks it. And for me personally, I've never had a memory come up that I'm like, that couldn't have happened or that's just really random. Or it's always been... when I had this memory on MDMA of being abused as a baby at the babysitter's, I didn't even know I was being babysat as a young child. And then I went back and asked my mother, and she's like, oh, yeah, from when you were 0 to about 2, we'd always bring you over to the neighbor's house, and they watched you while I taught preschool. And I had no idea that had happened. And another thing, too, that memory had been in the driver's seat as well most of my life, because I always wondered why I had some anger in me. I think that fed my journalism, which was good, but also, you know, I had that desire to stick up for the little guy and like fuck you to authority, and I never knew why I was so passionate like that. And I realized that was because of those memories of being abused as an infant.
So you're in the ultimate place. You were tortured as a child, then you use that as a power to be successful in your life, and now you're switching off the torture because you found ayahuasca. So now you're just happy and content and successful.
Exactly. But I still have a bit of that drive to now. My drive more than anything is just to try to connect people who need healing with these medicines. I feel like I have a duty to kind of pay it forward.
Well, you might have done that. Give me the number to blindfold Dr. E and... Because I'm going.
I think what the ayahuasca will do is the ayahuasca, which helps a lot of people who've been had childhood abuse, it will show you that maybe your father was abused and his father was abused.
He definitely was.
And it will show you the lineage so you can actually be the one to break that cycle. And there's a lot of studies.
I am the one to break that cycle.
Exactly. And so the ayahuasca will help you purge your, what it's good is helping people kind of purge their hate and understanding and forgiving. And then I think what the MDMA psychotherapy is good at doing is just being able to go back and process those memories and move them from a fear folder to a safe folder. So a little bit of both, like a combination, I think would be – I love how I'm not a doctor. I'm just a journalist. I'm completely sitting here diagnosing you. But I think that would be – I've just witnessed other people in similar situations.
Right.
And,
I get it.
And that would be effective, yeah.
Telly, the thing you said about it might be in your head, I've always thought that that's kind of an angle that you had. But I just realized today that I fucking took acid and ecstasy that day that I had an invisible friend telling me that stuff. And then my mother confirmed it in the morning. If it wasn't for that stuff, you know, isn't it a funny coincidence that I took all the things that in Australia that you could get besides stabbing yourself in the arm with a needle. Because I'm a pro skateboarder. That's ridiculous. I'm not going to do heroin. But I did every other thing that you could get that was around that time when I was, you know, like you got acid, you go, cool, give me that. You got ecstasy, cool. I did some lines. Nobody had cocaine. I would have done that too, but they only had speed because we were broke Australians. But isn't it funny that stuff in there, that was the day. Like nobody said that it was in my head and it was a mystery. When the day I said that, was the day everyone came out and it said, shit, we thought you would have forgot that because it happened at a young age.
And you don't forget anything. Your brain is like a computer hard drive. It records everything that happens to you your entire life. Whether you're able to access those memories or not is something else. But nothing that happens to you is really forgotten. Even if you technically have forgotten it, it's still stored in your brain.
Well, and paradoxically and tragically, in many cases, the stuff that's seems the most forgotten is actually the core memories and thoughts and opinions and attitudes that the first ones. So they're the bedrock of your understanding of life and your own existence. You think you don't forget them. You think you don't remember them at all. They're actually, like you say, driving the whole thing. And let me be clear. When I say that there are some retrieved memories that I think are invented or whatever, I'm certainly not saying all retrieved memories are. Just I think that there have been demonstrated instances in the same way that there have been eyewitnesses in murder trials who actually, as was later demonstrated, did not see what they thought they saw. You actually cannot fully 100% trust eyewitnesses. You cannot fully 100% trust retrieved memories. That's all I'm trying to say. I'm curious. I understand how you can make a living being a journalist for CNN. How do you make a living going around talking about ayahuasca?
That's a good question.
She probably just has tons of sugar daddies. Look at her. Yeah. I'll pay you money for a hug every day. So delightful.
The universe works in strange ways. But I started a website, reset.me, with information on all of these natural medicines.
What are you
therapies.
Wearing on them in the website?
What do you mean?
I mean, what do you got on when you're just like, hey, check out this ayahuasca? Do you got like a bikini on or something?
Maybe.
Yeah.
Yeah, go check out the site. You'll see.
Sneaky.
But I really felt as a journalist, like there was no place. Like right now, say you want to go and learn more about MDMA therapy, this is where you can go. You go to reset.me, scroll down under news. We have MDMA and all the articles collected of all of these people saying, you know, talking about how their therapy helped them, all the science, the studies, the experts speaking about it. And so it's just like one-stop shop to find out about all of these medicines if you really need to kind of hit that reset button in life. And I was frustrated because before I did ayahuasca, I didn't know where to find out information about it. And I would have appreciated a site like this. So I just kind of manifested it in my travels.
I'm too scared and too old to just find the dude in the bushes to give me one. I need somebody that's like, this guy has given this many people this thing and nobody died and it's all mellow and we're all, don't worry about it, we're leading you down the right path. That's the only reason I even thought about it, because I trust Aubrey at On It, and he was, you know, he's like, dude, I'm not going to, like, I've done it 1,000 times. I'm not taking you to a place where you're going to be in trouble. So I don't, and I trust him. Mm. Something about him. I don't know what it is. I think it was the day he told me about the ayahuasca thing that he, you know, and he saw his grandma and all this stuff, and it just, I'm really good at sniffing people's bullshit, and he wasn't lying. You know what I mean? Whether it happened or not, it happened in his head. I could tell for sure when he was telling me. I'm like, this is crazy that you're telling me that you saw your dead grandmother, because I have a dead little brother and stuff like that. And I'm like, if there's any chance that happens, it just sounded, it was like, as soon as he said it, I was like, I have to do that. I can't die before I have to do that to know, to, I just would like to be on the planet one day and be just completely okay
and just be free. Yeah. Free, like that's how I feel now. I just feel so, like you said, I have the glow. I just feel so free because I finally just literally purged all the trauma that I was carrying around, because so many of us are just carrying around bottled up trauma our whole lives, and we've unfortunately lost our ability to get rid of this trauma because we've made psychedelic medicines illegal.
The man is containing us. We're in a prison of his nightmares.
What will he not fuck up?
The only way out is to trip balls. Trip balls is the escape to the real world. It's like a fucking Matrix, man. It's not so drastic, but it's kind of like that. We got to get out. I got to get out. I got to get out of here.
It is true. I've known a handful of people who, I remember I used to work with this girl, and she was crazy, and she was lovely, but she was crazy, and she was, in, I think, pretty clearly an abusive relationship. I don't have any evidence, but it just seemed like, but it was one of these takes two to tango. She was this awful victim, and we used to say, she was the most lovely girl. If we could get inside her brain, we could fix her in 10 seconds.
Switch the bitch off.
And for the rest of her life, I'm willing to bet wherever she is right now, she's still running in the same little rat maze that she was when I knew her 15, 20 years ago. Mm. Any of us, if we could have just gotten and played with her brain, we could have fixed her like that, but she was never going to see what was completely obvious to everyone else who knew her, what was wrong with her. I don't know if psychedelic drugs were the answer for her, but
they'd probably do that. They'd probably right away hone in on, and there's something magical about them. They hone in right away on what's causing you this blockage, and they would probably say, put a mirror to her face and say, you're doing this. Like, why are you dating all these abusers?
You do the same thing over and over, and then you get upset about it over and over, and you don't realize that you're just perpetuating your same cycle, you know?
Amber, do you like guys?
Of course.
All right. Your name's Amber Lyon. Are you single? Do you meet people and say that your name's Amber Lyon and start talking to them?
Yeah.
That's wild.
I know, it is a crazy name. Like, people ask me if I made it up. It just kind of...
But you didn't.
My dad liked beer. So he's like, he named me after his favorite amber brew. I'd like to say it was something more mystical than that, but
you dropped off hard right there. You shouldn't have told... If we were at the bar and you said that you were named after beer, I'd have been like, oh. The Lyon thing was really pumping me up. But you're just a beer now? Like, come on.
Or it's also a jewel. Amber's a jewel.
Yeah,
so
let's go there. Because now you were a Lyon diamond. And I'm like, oh my God, a Lyon diamond that is shining. I'm super into it. Keep that angle, because you want to be you don't settle down. You can't settle down.
Me, I am in the process of settling down.
Right.
Yeah, for sure. Like, now I'm at a point in my life. I'm like, okay, you know, I'm ready to settle down, have kids.
Smart girl.
But I'll never completely settle down.
No, you're a lion.
Yeah.
No, you're an animal. You need to be tamed.
Exactly.
Not by me, but I'm just saying that's the fire that you have. I don't think it's a bad thing. I mean, as long as you don't get in your way.
Mm-hmm.
You ever punched a girl?
I have. Oh, I did, yeah. But it was for, I was doing a story on women's MMA fighting. So I was put in a cage with this girl, Michelle Gutierrez, who was like just a monster. And she just got on top of me and started doing a rear naked choke.
Yeah.
And so then I punched her.
You punch from behind, you punch her in the head.
Yeah.
She'd probably think that was funny.
Yeah. She didn't care. I was being choked out, so then I had to hit the mat, so she'd let me go.
Wow. As a reporter, you got in the cage and she like manhandled you and choked you out, and you had to do the tap thing.
Wrapped her legs around
my neck. Did you have a mouth guard on?
No, nothing. Like, I was just thrown to the wolves.
Did you have gloves on?
Nothing.
Wait, you bare knuckle punched her in the face?
Yeah.
Was that part of the deal, or did you just improvise that?
I think it's because my producers thought it'd be really funny, so they just
they said you should punch her.
No, they didn't tell me I should punch her, but they're just like, oh yeah, get in the cage with her. You know, it'll be a good experiential journalism segment. And next thing I know, my face is all red, and I'm like literally cannot breathe.
And punching her in the head with no gloves on.
Yeah.
Things have gone bad when you do that. You know that, right? Like, if you're the girl that's wrestling the reporter, and you're like, look, I'll give you a little fake chokey here. And then she's rabbit punching you in the head. You're like, okay, she's panicking and she's trying to fight for her life now. Things have gone. I would feel bad if you were punching me in the head because I feel like you're panicking.
I was, and I thought she'd take it easy on me.
Is that on video?
As a journalist. Yeah. And
where's
and
that?
She, I think it should be on CNN's website. It's like MMA, Amber Lyon. I think the video is still up there. And she took it really seriously. Like, she literally wrapped herself around me and started
see, we
cutting
think
off
that,
my air supply.
We think that you weren't prepared for it and she was taking it easy. But if she wasn't taking it easy and she was right, I've always wanted to beat the shit out of a hot chick, then you should have. Like, did she say anything about you punching her in the head afterwards?
No, I was just hitting her.
Oh,
like
my
this.
God. Yeah. Wait, were you actually landing?
I think so, yeah. What's so funny?
Because when you play with people that don't know how to fight and then they actually bare knuckle punch you in the head, that's funny. I'm sorry. That's funny.
I'm sure she was laughing. Like, I'm sure she got a kick out of it. I'm sitting here thinking I'm dying, and she's just like, this broad sucks.
It's weird that she went that. I want to see the video. You got it?
I have a 40-second clip.
Okay.
That seems to involve at least a little bit of ring time.
Hey, Michelle, how are you?
Welcome to Throwdown.
So she seems so innocent, you know?
They always do.
Home away from home.
Gotta watch them, Amber.
My house.
A house Michelle spends up to 40 hours a weekend. Pumping iron, training, from boxing and various forms of martial arts.
I'm about to get my ass kicked.
To wrestling.
This is called the triangle. Put my foot over.
Oh, geez. Yeah, I feel that.
And then squeeze my leg.
And so your goal in this is to choke me?
No, her goal is to get your face as close to her vagina as possible. That's really what she shot it. Yeah.
And tap. There we go.
Okay. I was like, there's something very sexual. Oh, that didn't get into more of the fighting.
Are you punching her into the head?
But yeah, there is something very sexual about it. It just was strange to have like another woman with her legs wrapped around my face like that.
I get used to it.
MMA sex is big. It's coming in. I'm on the streets. It's the new thing. I didn't catch that. I think it's a good thing that I didn't actually. You being offensive, Michael?
No, I'm not. Yeah, okay. Wolf Blitzer would never do that. Kudos to you.
No.
Oh, the wolf. He is so stoked that his show is called Wolf. It looks so cool on the channel thing. I got suckered into it because I don't know who he is. I'm like, Wolf, fucking sick. This must be awesome. Wait a minute. Why is this old guy talking about the news?
I know. Wolf Blitzer, blatant false advertising.
It is. He is the reverse Wolf Blitzer of all time. Like, that's a fucking, it's like Buck Rogers.
I know.
And he fucking dude's just an old bastard going, man, we're paying too much taxes. I'm like, oh my God, where's the wolf eating people in explosions?
Very little wolf, very little blitzing.
No lasers, nothing. I mean, Wolf Blitzer. It's going to be like a laser wolf or something, right?
Yeah.
He's got one of those news reporter voices we were talking about earlier. You got to beware of.
I think he has a little boner and he rubs it on people. Seems like that guy. You ever rubbed it on you? He was going to rub it. I know if I was him.
Maybe in the elevator. No, I'm just kidding.
Yeah, yeah. Totally. No. You don't want to get any more trouble.
Yeah.
Bunch of dudes in black suits waiting at the bottom of the building.
I know. It's been nice to know you guys.
Look, it's been really nice to have you on the show because this is the one. I really feel like this is the one. I have to do it now. It's like before I was like, maybe you'll face it one day. But there was that other thing. I was like, maybe you should just not do it, man. Maybe this is sometimes some people just can't get to that. You might be too late for it or something. But I think I think when we take a break, I'm going to get that number and I'm going to go try it.
Peeling the onion.
Yeah. I always say there's no mistakes in the universe, and I feel like the download I'm getting from this show is that I was sent here to like give you the message of the medicine.
Right, now I don't. Now I changed my mind completely.
Calm down, hippie.
Damn, I knew I shouldn't have thrown that one in. I gotta watch my talk.
Everybody should go to the website reset.me. That's your website, Amber.
Yes. And, if you want to learn about the medicines, it's all on there.
And at Amber Lyon on Twitter. You got an Instagram?
I Amber Lyon on Instagram.
Okay, because I need to follow all that too. Do you swim much on Instagram? we'll be back. Thank you.